Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being with us today. We're really glad you're here. We pray our service will be a blessing to you. Today is Easter, and we celebrate the fact that our Savior has risen from death and has won salvation for all of us. And our service today will focus on that wonderful news, and we'll have the reminder from the Lord that He wants us to listen to Him, especially as He proclaims this news to us. Let's rise. And we begin with a responsive reading. Why don't we take a moment for private meditation? We'll compose ourselves, and then we'll continue with the responsive reading. Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus. He is not here. He has risen. Why do you look for the living among the dead?
He is not here. He has risen.
Remember how He told you while He was still with you in Galilee.
The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Please be seated. We'll continue with the first hymn. Let's stand for the last verse. Verse 4, we will stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Dear people of God, I bring you good news. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us praise the Savior who was delivered over to death for our sins.
We praise Him for suffering the curse and punishment due for our sins.
Let us praise the Savior who was raised to life for our justification. Let us praise the Savior who has defeated death and has brought life and immortality to light.
Because he was raised, we too shall be raised from death. Because he lives, we too shall live.
Let us praise the Savior who has won eternal life for us. Let us sing to the Lord.
For he has done marvelous things.
Let everything that has breath praise the God of our salvation.
Praise him in his mighty heaven. Praise him for his surpassing greatness.
Rejoice, people of God. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Please be seated for the verses of hymn 143. We join our hearts in prayer. Almighty God, by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you conquered death and opened the gate to eternal life. Grant that we, who have been raised with him through baptism, may walk in newness of life and rejoice in the hope of sharing his glory. We pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be dominion and praise now and forever.
Amen.
Please give your attention to the words of Job chapter 19, verses 23 to 27. Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead or engraved in rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. Here ends our reading from Job. We join together in the responsive reading of selected verses from Psalm 103. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
All my inmost being, praise his holy name.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
And forget not all his benefits.
Who forgives all your sins, who redeems your life from the pit,
and crowns you with love and compassion.
The Lord is compassionate and gracious,
slow to anger and abounding in love.
He does not treat us as our sins deserve,
or repay us according to our iniquities.
For as high as the heavens are above the earth,
so great is his
As far as the east is from the west,
so far has he removed our transgressions from us.
Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts.
You do his service to do his will.
Praise the Lord, all his works. Praise the Lord, O my soul. We join in singing the hymn, Christian Salute This Happy Day. The tune is familiar from the Lutheran hymnal, hymn 212. Note that the last couple verses are a little different from the Christian worship. We hear Luke's account of the resurrection story is found in Luke chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly, two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Here ends our scripture lesson. We'll join in singing hymn 165. Note, the choir sings the first and fourth verses. The congregation is asked to join in verses 2 and 3. We hear the words of 1 Corinthians 15, the first 11 verses. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise you have believed in vain. For what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all he appeared to me also as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it was I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believe. Here ends our scripture. Listen, we join together in singing hymn 160. We join together in the responsive reading from 1 Corinthians 15. If you're following in your worship folder, it's on page 8. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, if there is no resurrection of the dead,
then not even Christ has been raised.
And if Christ has not been raised,
our preaching is useless, and so is your faith.
More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. But he did not raise him, if in fact the dead are not raised.
For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either.
And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile.
You are still in your sins.
Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. For since death came through a man,
the resurrection of the dead
comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die,
so in Christ all
will be made alive. The choir sings, "Welcome, happy morning." Please rise for the confession of faith. What therefore do you believe about Jesus Christ?
I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, purchased and won me from all sins, from death and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy, precious blood and his innocent suffering and death. All this he did that I should be his own and live with him in his kingdom and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he has risen from death and lives and rules eternally. This is most certainly true.
Please be seated as we join in singing hymn 150, Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
We'll rise. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. The words of God we'll consider on this festival of Easter are written in the 16th chapter of the Gospel of St. Mark. We'll start with verse 1. When the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they could go and anoint Jesus. Very early on the first day of the week, at sunrise, they went to the tomb. They were saying to each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance for the tomb for us?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. He said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." They went out and hurried away from the tomb, trembling and perplexed. They said nothing to anyone, because they were afraid. This is God's word. Please be seated. In the name of Jesus, our crucified and risen Savior, dear joyful Christians, if only they had listened. It had been said any number of times, if only they had listened, they wouldn't have had the sorrow of heart, they wouldn't have been wondering, they wouldn't have been worrying, they wouldn't have been questioning things. If only they had listened, they wouldn't have not had spiritual anguish, mental anguish, even emotional anguish. If only they had listened. The women, well, They wouldn't have wasted their money buying spices to anoint a body that wasn't going to be there. If they had listened, they wouldn't have been worried about who was going to roll that stone away. If they had listened, they would have known there was no reason to anoint that body because it wasn't going to be there. If they had listened, the disciples would not have been questioning what the woman told them. Remember what we read a little bit earlier? Their words seemed like nonsense to them. If they had listened, they wouldn't have been startled with fear when Jesus finally did appear to them. If she had listened, Mary Magdalene wouldn't have gone running off thinking somebody had stolen Jesus' body. If Thomas had listened, would he be known forever as doubting Thomas? Kind of interesting. Jesus' enemies listened. The people who hated him, the people who engineered his death, they listened. In fact, when Jesus was put in the tomb, they went to Pilate and they said, "You know what he said? He said, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.'" So his enemies knew. Why didn't his followers get it? If only they had listened. And it was on more than one occasion that Jesus told them plainly what was going to happen. "We're going to Jerusalem. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. He's going to be put to death. On the third day, he's going to rise again." He made the comparison between himself and Jonah in the sea creature, that just as Jonah was in that fish for 3 days, the Son of Man would be in the heart of the earth, and on the third day, he would rise again. Very plain. Why didn't they listen? It's easy for us to find fault with them. Who knows what was going in their minds or how this would have sounded absurd that maybe he was going to come back from the dead. We don't know all the reasons why they didn't. But we know the evidence. We know the truth, and God speaks to us, and he wants us also to listen. He speaks to us in his word, assures us his word is truth, tells us what we need to know, so that we can be right with our God. And this morning, he speaks to us with that wonderful news, and he wants us to listen to that good news. Christ has risen. So let's use that thought as our theme as we look at these words of God before us today. Listen to the good news. Christ is risen. We'll see, first of all, the good news is really true. Second, we'll see, because the good news is true, our worst problems are solved. Finally, we'll see this good news is meant to be shared with others. Now, in these words of God before us today, it's that very first Easter morning, and Mary Magdalene, another woman named Mary, and another woman named Salome were all on their way to the tomb, and were told that they had purchased spices and they were going to anoint Jesus' body. And on their way, they're wondering, what's going to happen? How are we going to get into the tomb? Well, if they had listened, they would not have wasted their money on the spices. We're told they entered the tomb and they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. He said to them, "Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here." God wanted them to know this wonderful news. And an angel was there to tell them the news. And he pointed, "Look, see the place where they laid him. He's not there anymore." He wanted them to realize the news is true. And we're thankful the Lord emphasizes that there's no doubts for us. You think of the angels who were there. We're told that Jesus gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to people on numerous occasions. And we have the testimony of those eyewitnesses. Those eyewitnesses wrote things down for us, recorded for us. And we have the testimony of the men who followed him, the people who followed him, what they were willing to suffer, how some were willing to die for him. The evidence of history, we have the words of the Holy Scriptures telling us for sure he has risen. The Lord wants us to be sure, to believe the good news. It is really true. And what comfort that is for us is if there's ever any doubts about Jesus, his resurrection clears them up. And we read just a little bit ago if he's not risen? If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, so is your faith. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, you are still in your sins. If Jesus has not been raised, then he's a fake, Christianity is a hoax, and we are the biggest fools in the history of the world for following him, for dedicating our lives to him. The Lord wants us to know the news is true. All the things that God has done to record this for us, to make it plain for us, so that there's no doubt whatsoever. Listen to the good news. Christ has risen. The good news really is true. And because it's true, then, it solves our worst problems. Now, kind of interesting, we talked about it a little bit ago. The women were on their way to the tomb. They wanted to anoint Jesus' body, and they were wondering, how are we going to get into the tomb? And we're told that when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. We're told earlier that an angel came and had pushed the stone away, letting everyone know that the grave is empty. Jesus isn't there. He has risen. And because he has risen, well, that solves the worst problems of all for us, right? The sad fact that I don't like to think about is that I'm going to die one day. It's just a matter of time. Who knows when, who knows how, but it's going to happen. And I don't like to think about that. And sometimes I might be afraid to think about that. But then I can tell myself the good news, Christ has risen. And what does that mean? It means that we live forever. Jesus has done everything that is necessary so that we can be right with God. It's proof that he really is the Savior of the world. And no other person, no other religious leader, no one has ever done what he has done to both predict that he would die and predict that he would come back to life and have it come true exactly as he said it would. Proof he really is the Son of God, the one that we can trust in. And we think about that. He made those predictions and they came true. You can look at predictions from the Old Testament, or you think of things in the Psalms, Psalm 16 or Isaiah 53. Jesus fulfilled those prophecies. He came back to life as was predicted. So, proof. God's words are true. We can believe them. We can be sure of them. And it can happen sometimes that certain promises we might struggle with. We might wonder. You think of the promise. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. And the temptation is there maybe to doubt that. You look at something and it seems so horrible, so awful. And part of me thinks, how can this ever work for anyone's good? How could this ever work for my good? Then I can remember. God does keep his promises. Proof in the resurrection. Christ is risen. He kept that promise. I can be sure he'll keep this one too. Or the promise from 1 Corinthians 12, that God will not tempt us beyond what we are able to bear. In other words, God does not give us more than we can handle. He gives us that promise. He's with us and will strengthen us. And it can happen sometimes that you're pushed to your limits and you're thinking, I don't think I can handle this anymore. Is that promise really true? And I can tell myself, God kept his promise to raise Jesus from the dead. He'll keep this promise too. And the Apostle Paul tells us, when I'm weak, I'm strong. And sometimes the Lord lets us get to that point where we feel like we just can't take anymore. We feel like we're not going to make it. We have no choice but to put ourselves in his hands and let him take over. And that's really then when we're at our strongest. You think of other promises, that he loves us always, that he hears our prayers, that he always answers them in the way that is best. And even then those words, those who live and believe in me never die. Comfort there is for us. If I'm afraid, to die, and sometimes I might be. I can tell myself I'm going to keep on living. I might leave this world, I'm going to leave my body, but I'm going to keep on living. I'm going to live with my Lord in heaven. And when my heart is broken because somebody I care about has been taken from me, and I wonder about them, I can remember, again, those who live and believe in Jesus never die. That our loved ones who knew and trusted in Jesus, they are in a place that's better by far. And we miss them, and it's hard to go on without them, but we know they are with Jesus enjoying the greatest bliss of all. And the same Lord still loves me. And one day he will take me there too. One day we will all be together again, never to be separated again. And in the meantime, I can cling to those promises that God will heal me and help me and guide me and see me through all things and indeed work all things for my good, even when he takes someone precious from me. And I can be sure about these things because he is risen. God shows, he demonstrates, he makes it plain. He keeps his promises, his words are true. He say, help us, Lord, to listen. Help us to listen to the good news. Again, the disciples were struggling because they hadn't been listening, paying attention. And we're told then that the angel talked to the women. He says, go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. Can we understand or appreciate the roller coaster of emotions that the disciples had been on, that they'd gone through? If you want to back up a week, it's Palm Sunday. Jesus rides in, and there you have those multitudes of people shouting his praises. Hosanna to the Son of David. Thursday night, they're having a quiet meal together. Later that night, he's arrested. The next morning, he's condemned. A little bit later, he's on the cross. By late in the afternoon, he's dead. And then in the evening, he's in the tomb. And all of a sudden, their world had revolved around him. He was their Lord. They believed in him, and all of a sudden, he's dead. The disciples on the way to Emmaus said, we had thought that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. All of a sudden, there's doubts. Well, the news was there for them. Christ has risen. They needed that news to be assured all is well. He really is your Savior. He really is your Lord. All will be okay. Kind of interesting that the angel says, especially Peter. Tell the disciples and Peter. And we know what Peter had done, right? And you think back, again, Thursday, earlier, bragging, boasting, I'll never deny you. Kind of interesting because Jesus had even told him ahead of time, this is going to happen. And he wouldn't listen. He said, oh, no, I'll never deny you. He said, even if I have to die for you, I'll never deny you. And what happens? Some people challenge him, they corner him, and he says, I don't know the man. And the third denial, in fact, he calls a curse on himself. He takes an oath. He's swearing up and down, I don't know this man. And what happens? It's at that moment Jesus is being led from one place to another, happens to be passing by near where Peter is. And there's Peter swearing up and down, I don't know the man, and all of a sudden he turns, and whose eyes does he meet? But and there's Jesus looking at him. Can you imagine how he would have felt? He goes outside, and we're told he broke down and wept bitterly. But then think of one more thing. As far as we know, that's the last time he saw his Lord before Jesus died. How would you feel if the last experience you had with somebody you cared about was something like that? To have to live with yourself. The last time I saw my Lord, I was swearing I didn't even know who he was. Peter especially with the guilt and the weight of what he had done, needed to know the news. He's risen. He's alive. You're going to see him again. Things are going to be okay. And we wonder sometimes how many of us have ever been like Peter, that we did something that we're just so ashamed of, and then it finally hit us, what have I done? And we felt awful. Sometimes you just feel even sick inside because of the sin you committed. And then even in your minds, what does the Lord think of me? What's going to happen? And then we remember those words. Listen to the good news. Christ has risen. You have a living Savior, and that's God's way of saying he really is your Savior. He really did die for you. He really has paid for your sins. He really has fixed everything. God is not angry at you. He does not look down at you with anger and disgust because you've made mistakes. Through Jesus, he sees you as just right because your sins are gone. His face beams at you. How many times don't we say that at the end of the service? The Lord make his face shine upon you. And you can be sure his face shines upon you because you're his forgiven child, righteous in his sight, just what he wants. You can be sure he still loves you and always will. And sometimes it can happen that we're devastated because of something that we've done. And it can happen sometimes maybe we're devastated because of something somebody else has done and how much it hurts. And again, sometimes we wonder, how am I going to deal with this? How am I going to handle it and go on? And then again, listen to the good news. Christ has risen. God has made you his child. He keeps his promises. He sees you through all things, even this thing that maybe has devastated you or hurt you more than you thought you could ever handle. God knows. God will heal you. God will help you. He will see you through and make sure that in the end, you are blessed. Wonderful news. News the Lord wants us to listen to. And he wants other people to listen to that news as well. Right? The angel told the women, go tell the disciples and Peter. And the Lord tells us, of course, to preach the good news to all creation. And we remember again the work that God has given us to do, to tell people Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus Christ died for you, no matter who you are. Jesus Christ has wiped away your sins, no matter what they might be. Through Jesus Christ, you are a dear child of God. Through Jesus Christ, you can be sure that God will love you always, no matter what. Through Jesus Christ, you can be sure that you will live forever in heaven. That's the work that God has given us to do. And again, the devil may try to fill us with doubts and wondering, well, how do we know Christianity is the one true right religion in the world? How do we know we should be doing all this to tell other people that Jesus is the way to eternal life? Why don't we just let other people do what they're comfortable with? If they're happy in their religion, why don't we just leave them that way? Because we know Christ has risen, and this means he is the Savior. He is the one who gives us eternal life. He is the one that we need to believe in. He is the one that all people need to believe in. Christ has risen. That's the news. We know it's true. We know it solves our greatest problems. It's news for us. It's news for others. And this is why we're celebrating today, because we know the news. We know what it means. We know what we have. We know we're God's children who will live forever. So we have every reason to rejoice, to be happy, and to keep on listening to the good news. Christ has risen. Amen. You may remain seated. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. We'll continue with the offering. As we gather the offering, we will sing the posted hymn verses. We'll rise. And we'll join in the responsive Easter prayer. Dear Father in heaven, what joy we have today because of your Son, Jesus. Though he was dead, we know that Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Heavenly Father, we have assurance of our salvation, confidence that our sins are forgiven, and the guarantee of our own resurrection from death because we know. We thank you, Lord, for the faithful testimony of eyewitnesses which you have recorded for us on the pages of your Holy Scriptures. We are thankful that each one of us can know for certain.
It is true. The Lord has risen.
You delivered your Son over to death for our sins and raised him to life for our justification. Lord, we know that death will come to all of us, but there can be no doubt about the victory we have over death.
Jesus rose from death, so we can be sure we also rise from the dead to live forever.
Because of Jesus' resurrection, we have true reasons for having joy and confidence in our lives. We thank you for the many earthly blessings that you allow us to enjoy in this life. We certainly praise you for them. Help us to remember, Lord, that these are not the most important blessings of all. Help us to remember that the joys of this earth will one day end, but the glories of eternity are better by far and will never end. We can be absolutely sure of this, Lord, because we know. Help us, Lord, to joyfully live our lives for you. Help us, Lord, to share this comforting news with others. We offer two special prayers today, Lord. Both prayers of thanks, first of all for Bob Frisky, the father of Penny Beegler, who underwent emergency surgery. We thank you, Lord, that the surgery was a success and that it appears he is going to be okay. Help him with the pain and discomfort that comes after the surgery. If it's your will, grant him a full and complete recovery. Please, Lord, keep him close to you and help him always to look to you in faith, trusting in your promises that you are with him always to guide and help and bless him. We also offer a special prayer of thanks for Luella Hansen, the infant daughter of Mike and Emma Hansen, who had been facing some potentially serious health issues. Lord, we thank you that all of these have come to nothing and that she is going to be okay. Thank you, Lord, for sustaining parents, grandparents, and family members who were concerned about her well-being. Help us, Lord, to always trust that you are with us, even our little ones about whom we care so much. Please continue to watch over this little girl and keep her as your own forever. And help all of us to know that you watch over each one of us to guide us and love us and bless us. Hear us, Lord, as we now bring you our private petitions. Heavenly Father, we praise you for your great love, for Jesus' death and resurrection, and for the many blessings we have through him. What a difference it makes knowing Christ is risen. In Jesus' name we also join in praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Brothers and sisters, may the good news of Jesus' resurrection live in your hearts and bring you blessings today and always. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. We'll close with the final hymn.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. We're glad you're here. We pray God's word you heard was a blessing for your life. Special welcome to all the visitors who are here with us today. We're really glad you are here, too. Please sign our guest book, and if you'd like, we'll get you a visitor packet that'll tell you or give you more information about our church. A couple of things we'd like to share with you. First of all, anyone who donated an Easter lily may take it home. Please don't take the ones on the cross here, okay? Please take them from one of the ones on the altar or the front there. Thank you for all of them. They look beautiful this morning, and if possible, maybe we could get some pictures before everyone takes them, because it looks really nice. So we're back to a regular schedule then this coming week. Wednesday, Women's Bible Study. Our midweek Bible class will resume at 10:30. Confirmation classes back to their normal day and time on Wednesday. Choir the same. If you'd like, we have a special Easter DVD. It's only $2. We have copies on the bulletin table. In fact, we've got plenty in the back room. If they run out, let us know. We'll get you one. And there's plenty there. 2 weeks from today, quarterly voters meeting, 10:15. You can see the note on the Trinity Lutheran School musicals. And I think the other thing we'll just mention is we have new members. The Lord has blessed us with new people. Brandon and Christina Flack and their children finished the Bible information course. Brandon and Christina, their oldest daughter, will be joining us as communicant members, and their children then join us under our spiritual care. We're really glad they're here. We pray our church will be a blessing to them, and they will be a blessing to us as well. I think those are the announcements. We will just say one more time, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Good morning. God bless you, everyone. Happy Easter.